and support all of the members of their communities. So one of the ways we intend to implement these new values is through education. And that's why we chose inclusive services as the theme for our meeting today. So we are starting our meeting out with our four community member speakers, and they're going to be Jessica McPhail, who's the director of the Racine Public Library, Lisa Visbicki, who's the director of the Beloit College Library, Tasha Saker, who's the assistant director of the Appleton Public Library, and Raina Bloom, the public services librarian from College Library at UW-Madison. I'm going to let them provide any other introduction they'd like to at the beginning of their talks, but I just want to say how happy and thrilled we are to have each of them talking with you today. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jessica.
Hi, everyone. It's Jessica McPhail. I'm the director at the Racine Public Library. I've been here since 1999. And why is this topic of inclusion so important to me? I think we're all trying to figure out where we fit into the new global landscape. And something that makes sense to me is to figure out first, whose land are we on? Whose land do we stand on and sit on and live in and work in? It puts a different perspective when you start to think we are the interlopers here, that we are temporarily graced with living in this space. And I think looking through that lens, it starts to make sense why we need to be inclusive, because that's how we're going to be able to make sense of things. So that's why it's important to me. Who are we and what are we doing here in this place? What is Racine doing? Since 2006, we've been showing movies once a month with themes of race and racism in partnership with an anti-racism organization called Coming Together Racine. We then started a monthly book group, again with themes of race and racism, that turned into a weekly book group, again with themes of race and racism, because these folks wanted to delve even deeper into the books we were reading and start to relate what we're reading to our own lives. This is a multicultural group, although I hate that word. There are people from all different ethnicities participating. We also have some terrific programs. We've partnered with America's Black Holocaust Museum and the Wisconsin Historical Society, I'm getting that name wrong, to bring programs here that reflect our community, the community who lives here. And that's been really successful, reflecting back our Hispanic heritage, our Native American heritage, and our African American heritage, as well as the newer people in the realm of historical values, newer immigrants. And resources that have been incredibly helpful to me, reading, and talking. Our staff has been talking. We've had this topic at several staff meetings. As a result, there are 6 staff members who are going to be attending the series that the YWCA is putting on called Unlearning Racism. That's been in Milwaukee for almost 20 years. Now it's coming to Racine, and I'm really excited about that. Look at the partners that are in your own locales. What is the Historical Society doing? What about the groups like the African American Ministers Roundtable? Those kinds of associations and partners can be really helpful in promoting programs. There's also a free online course, I don't remember where it's out of, but it's called Coursera, C-O-U-R-S-E-R-A. And there are online courses that you can audit for free to improve your own knowledge. I'd be happy to answer any questions when it's appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jessica. I really appreciate all of that information, and I love the framing to start us off, right, to really be thinking about the land that we're living on. So thank you so much. All right. Our next speaker is Lisa Visbicki, who is the director of the Beloit College Library.
Good morning, everyone, and a big thanks to Steph and to the WiLS community for bringing this topic to us all today. And I'm really grateful for the way Jessica got us started again with that framing. And I'm looking forward to hearing from the rest of our presenters and from the WiLS community, I mean, responding to some of the questions that I think are going to be shared with us throughout the presentation today. So the question of why is this topic important? Why does it matter to me? I think because it enriches us all as individuals and organizations, it encourages us to learn and grow and evolve in our collections and our services, our perspectives, and our ways of knowing. I think for me personally, it's opened new pathways for discussion and development and to think about the way and the why that I do my work. I think as already suggested, it allows us to fulfill our mission to support our entire community, but it also increases the satisfaction that our community has and the support that they have for our services. So it's kind of good for the bottom line if you want to look at it that way. But I think what really matters to me about it is that reproducing sameness is dull. So bringing inclusivity and diversity spaces helps us resolve that pretty speedily. And I, within the larger context of Beloit College as an institution, and our institution has kind of taken a big step forward, and it being a predominantly and historically white institution has set forth a proclamation that we as Beloit College aspire to become an anti-racist institution. And one of the ways that we operationalize this is to say that we're providing equal opportunity to be successful regardless of racial or other identities. And so, you know, this goes for us, the ideas of welcoming individuals from diverse backgrounds. We approach equity and inclusion from a number of angles simultaneously, including a lot of work that we have from kind of three really big projects that are kind of long-term that encourage us all to examine our culture and the structures of our organization and encouraging us to remove barriers that might be preventing us from in our community. One of the things that we have going on, it's been going on for 4+ years, that engages students in some and then faculty, staff, and others, is something called sustained dialogue. It's a space where we explore race, power, and privilege from an individual perspective, and we begin to identify the organizational beliefs and structures, as well as the processes that create unequal impact. So there's kind of a way of thinking about this as kind of decentering ourselves in our space here. One of the other longer-term projects that we have going on is the embracing of universal design for learning principles and creating learning opportunities for faculty to explore the application of universal design to reduce barriers to learning and improve outcomes for all. So currently this work involves addressing access to learning materials, making them actually accessible, pedagogical approaches that incorporate multiple methods of engagement and presentation and expression. So one way to think about the project is to see it as decentering ableism. And another big project that we have that's grant funded by the Mellon Foundation is called Decolonizing Pedagogies. And it was developed by faculty and staff in our academic affairs, academic affairs office, as well as our critical identity studies program. And this project seeks to broaden the scope of our instructional content. So it engages faculty and staff in a long-term reading series that places our focus on equity and inclusion. And it asks us to really frankly look beyond the assumptions and the canon of whiteness and the Western civilization writ large, and to really look for ways that we are creating space for and honoring diverse and critical responses to what is essentially the dominant culture. So the kind of the framing for this would be decentering whiteness in our classroom and in our offices. There's a couple of other projects that are happening in kind of more one-off based. There's some training that's been going on called Safe Zone Training that's designed to help people appreciate and be supportive of the LGBTQ plus identities that we have on campus and to be responsive to space and needs in that area as well. And another kind of smaller project that's happening is the introduction of asset-based pedagogies, which asks us to be inclusive of a variety of learning experiences, engaging the strengths of all of our students. So rather than viewing instruction as an opportunity to fill or repair a deficit, it's elevating what we all bring to the table and learning from one another in new ways. So those are institutional efforts that the library, all aspects of our library have been engaged in, and we bring our experiences within those larger projects to the conversations that we have in our ongoing conversations with faculty and our consultation and in the teaching that we do ourselves. So we're amplifying the intersections of these projects and looking for ways to encourage people to come along. And this might be working with them on the use of open education resources and implementing open pedagogy, or encouraging faculty to redevelop assignments to incorporate universal design concepts, selecting materials for our collection that reduce or eliminate the need for accommodation, and thinking about the way we evaluate our sources, questioning the nature of authority and the reproduction of knowledge as it has been rolling forth in various disciplines. One of the other things that we are doing is really looking on kind of the long view and hoping to align support and create pathways for underrepresented individuals to join us in librarianship. So we're connecting our students with a Mellon-funded opportunity for our ACM school colleagues that creates a structured support process, allowing students interested in library science to be supported through the application and acceptance in the grad school program, and then sustaining a mentoring and support relationship for their success throughout the program. So ultimately, all this work that we're doing is designed to prepare spaces in liberal arts environments that empower underrepresented individuals and support their professional growth in whichever role they choose to take within the organization. And we're challenging ourselves to take action rather than to repeat narratives. And the resources that I've shared here are just some of the ones that are most loudly repeated in the circles that I travel in, that all will lead you to plenty of other opportunities to explore. So thank you again, Will.
Thank you so much, Lisa. There is so much great information in there. It's impressive to hear everything that your institution is doing, but also how well you as the library are working to support that and doing your own initiatives as well. And I love the reducing sameness, or the quote you said, reducing sameness is dull. Like, I'll take that away with me today. Thank you so much. Okay, our next speaker is Tasha Saker, who's the Assistant Director at Appleton Public Library. I did want to mention Tasha is also one of our WiLS board members, so I'm going to turn it over to Tasha.
Thank you. And I have to say, Steph, that being on the board is as much, you know, probably even more an honor than you understand. So I really appreciate being part of this as well. Jessica and Lisa have blown me away. I'm hoping I can live up to the standard that they've set. Jessica's introduction really moved me. So why I think that this is important is it's how I serve my community best. If we don't look at diversity and inclusion in a really holistic way as an organization, then we're not serving the community in the best way we can. If we hire staff who are diverse, we have found that more diverse patrons use our library. So like Lisa said, it's good for the bottom line as well. Otherwise, we have entire populations that do not see themselves as welcome in the library. And it also helps us address language barriers. So we have for years here in Appleton had librarians who took Spanish classes and struggled to meet the needs of Spanish speakers in our community at the desk. And by hiring people who are native Spanish speakers, it has completely turned that around. And we have people on staff that we can turn to for that help. So one of the big things that I do at Appleton is I do most of the hiring here. It's one of my favorite parts of my job. I'm involved in almost every hire if it's somebody with benefits. So somebody half-time or more. And we have found that we have to look really closely at the way that we're hiring people. Some of the major things that librarians just automatically look for are actually barriers to people who are writing applications who don't speak English as a first language. And so we've had to look at those things that we see that are, you know, grammatical errors. If it's a person who's doing children's programming, for example, maybe it doesn't matter that they have grammatical errors in their application. We can overlook that and worry about that in our data-driven jobs. We've also worked really closely with our city HR to reprioritize things, which means that sometimes I have to be the librarian who gets a little grumpy in hiring processes and pushes quite a bit to say that this is important for us. As most of you know, the libraries in a city are the ones that lead the way sometimes in these social matters, and I take a lot of pride in doing that with our city HR. Another way that we've removed barriers in Appleton is we were part of a citywide point initiative. It was a poverty, looking at eliminating poverty in the valley. And we were one of the only library teams that were part of that. And we took it really seriously. And one of the things that we took away from it was something called PDSA. And PDSA is a way to look at doing very small iterative changes that turn out to be large changes. What that lets us do as librarians is walk away from having to have that perfect model that you roll out this monumental model and you know that it's perfect already, and you move instead to iterative changes, which is you try something, you change it, try it again, change it. And that has revolutionized the way that we kind of work as a staff on implementing change here. One of the big things that it's brought about is that we now offer a lot more internet time than we had before. We had assumed that it wasn't possible to offer people more internet time. And once we try it in this kind of iterative way, you discover where the sweet spot is, where we can offer it, do more than we used to, but not more than we can handle. One of the important things I think is that administration has to buy in on this. And I'm speaking as an administrator. So we have to be vocally supportive of diverse staff, serving a diverse community, which means people who are living in severe need. And so when the library gets called a homeless shelter and we get that kind of stigma put on us in the community, we have to embrace that too and say we serve everyone in this community. And we are a microcosm of your larger community in one place. So administration has to put money and effort toward removing those barriers and serving the underserved. So some of the resources that I would recommend, and you'll have to remember that I'm a recovering children's librarian. So some of these are kind of children related, but they're wonderful. And I think that if you look at them, even as somebody not you doing children's literature, it's interesting. So there's a tremendous blog called Reading While White. And if you want to see what it looks like to put aside your privilege, it is the women who are the librarians who are writing on there who are just incredible. Project Implicit is something being done by Harvard where you can take a quiz to see where your implicit biases are, and that's at implicit.harvard.edu. I'd also recommend the Librarian's Guide to Homelessness. His name is Ryan Dowd. He's from the Chicago area. And if you are working in a public library with a homeless population, he sends out weekly emails that will kind of change your perspective on people who have grown up in systemic poverty and how we can better serve them by laying aside some of our biases. And then I just saw this morning that Library Journal has an article called How to Make the Library More Inclusive. And I can share the link to that in the chat as well.
Thank you so much, Tasha. That's great resources. We really, really appreciate it, and great ideas for things to do. And I love that notion of the, using the small iterative changes. We talk about that from just a perspective of how to be more like that lean startup kind of concept, right? But to use that in this type of initiative is great. Thank you for sharing that. So I am going to now introduce our last speaker, who is Raina Bloom from the public. She's the public services librarian, College Library, UW-Madison. And I am actually going to let her run her own slides here. So hang on just a minute while I make her a presenter. Okay, Raina, I think you should have control now. You may have to share your screen. Great, we are seeing it. Thanks. Raina, I'm not sure if you're talking, but we are not hearing you if you are. Okay, I'm not sure what's happening with Raina here with her connection. So I'm wondering if we should give her a second and see if we can figure out what's going on with that. And we can skip forward and talk a little bit about your responses to the first question. So let me just advance past her slides and we'll come back to her. Oh, actually, before we do that, I can tell you a little bit about some other initiatives. Just one second here. So there was a couple other things that came to our attention as we were preparing for this meeting. And one of them is Tessa Michelson-Schmidt, the Public Library Youth and Inclusive Services Consultant at the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction, is coordinating the inaugural Inclusive Services Institutes, which is a professional development and work group opportunity for Wisconsin Public Library and regional system staff who are committed to making Wisconsin libraries more inclusive to all community members and potential library users. So this institute's gonna have reflective learning experiences on the topics of equity and social justice. And they'll be working in small teams to actually develop tools for a new statewide resource. So as soon as that resource is available, we'll definitely share that through the WiLS channels with all of you. And they've also created an inclusive services statement from the Division of Libraries and Technology. This is going to form the foundation of the institute, but we also wanted to share that with all of you. So this will be linked in the slides that we share. The other thing I wanted to mention is that Alyssa Coughlin and Jean Zanoni from Marquette University are surveying academic library directors on their library's efforts related to diversity, equity, inclusion. And they're going to be presenting a session at WAL called Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion, Charting the Course for Justice and Excellence in Academic Libraries. So they wanted to provide a snapshot of diversity initiatives in Wisconsin academic libraries. So for those of you on the call from academic libraries, if you have a few minutes to help them, the link to the survey is here. The deadline to complete it is March 15th, and I'm sure they would be very, very grateful for any information you can send them. Okay, let me check back in here with Raina. Raina, do you have, can we hear you now? think she is trying to call in, so we might have her in just a minute. Her mic was working fine, okay. And then it stopped working. So it looks like she is calling in right now, or it looks like she's joined us.
Yeah, I am. Can you hear me now?
Yes, fantastic. So Raina, do you want to be presenter again?
Yeah, absolutely. That was so bizarre. My mic was working just fine until it was time for me to talk to everybody.
Okay, it looks like you are presenter already.
Okay.
Are people seeing your screen though?
Not yet. You have to go ahead and accept the show your screen, Raina.
Okay. Let me go ahead and do that.
Okay, there. Okay. Perfect. Thanks.
All right. Sorry for the technical drama, everybody. Thank you so much for inviting me to join you all today. And I am so impressed and so humbled by the stories and the experiences and the resources that Jessica and Lisa and Tasha have shared before I had an opportunity to speak today. There were some wonderful things in there. Thank you. So I want to talk a little bit about College Library to provide some context, because I think it's important for this particular topic this morning. So College Library, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, is the undergraduate library at UW-Madison. And our work here at this library is very patron-led and very responsive, as is the case at most libraries. But we have the tremendous luck of having undergraduates, very early career college students, as our primary patron base, which give us ample opportunities to explore many of the issues that we are talking about today. So let me go on ahead and answer some of these questions that were put to me. There we go. So why is this important to me? So I tend to think of information as being a social justice issue, and that idea and that notion of information being connected to justice is one of the bedrocks of my professional practice. And I also think of questions of information and being informed as being really intimately tied to questions of justice in libraries. So things like, what does it mean to be literate? What counts as literacy? What counts as illiteracy? And what types of literacy do we prioritize are things that I spend a lot of time thinking about. What does it mean to be informed? How do we make it more or less easy for different groups of people to become informed? I find this particularly challenging in an academic context because we set up barriers between people and our resources all of the time for better or worse reasons at times. So who has access? What financial barriers do we create, like I was just saying, for different groups of people? What barriers do tools like search algorithms and systems of organization that we prefer to think of as neutral create for people who want to become informed? And then the question of what access really means. What does it mean to be able to find information without the necessary education to contextualize and interpret it? Is access the mere presence of information, or should it be something richer? So these are questions that I think about a lot in my work that I feel like come up a lot in our collective work here at college. So I wanted to put them all before you today. So the next question, like the other speakers, that I was asked to think about, so what are we doing exactly to support these ideas of equity, diversity, inclusion, social justice, however you want to frame it. Here at College Library, we tend to think of social justice as being everybody's job. And some of the ways that we make that happen is by articulating it in our public service principles. So up on the screen right now is a quote from our public services principles document, which is a collectively and collaboratively authored and edited document that we created. So we support social justice by providing inclusive and equitable service in all our areas of operation, including face-to-face interactions, our space design, our community participation, and our policy and goal structures. Some more specific examples, though. We have a question about diversity and inclusion efforts in our performance review language. So when we're going through our annual review, every employee is required to respond to a question about how their work that year furthers the diversity and inclusion efforts, the social justice efforts of the library. We do a lot of training with permanent staff. We bring in outside speakers with expertise, including staff from the LGBT Campus Center, the McBurney Center, which is a center on campus for students with learning disabilities and differences. And we also do work to train ourselves internally with the support of readings, videos, whatever we can find and bring in. There's a lot of stuff, a lot of examples I could provide from our spaces, our collections, our displays. We recently converted our ethnic studies reading room to a collaborative space that we hope our campus partners want to come in and use, have talks, have movies, things like that in the space. I'm looking out the window right now at our Black History Month display in our second floor area, where we brought in a scholar of Black history at the UW to find some really great archival images of Black history at the University of Wisconsin, put them up on our walls, they're beautiful. We do pop-up displays on current events issues, things like that. They're very easy to do. Just use what's already in the collection, make a sign, put it out there. And we're also doing a lot more increasingly conscious work to make our collections representative of a variety of viewpoints. And we pay particular attention to marginalized viewpoints as of late. We have a diversity resident librarian program, and I was so glad to hear some of my colleagues talk about their own programs around hiring and training and bringing underrepresented people into librarianship. So we hire early career colleagues from underrepresented groups in librarianship for a three-year program. College libraries are home base for the first year, but then they may go elsewhere on campus for the subsequent 2 years. And we feel a very strong obligation to not only hire these professionals, but also to train them and mentor them and support them and acknowledge the position that we are putting them in as underrepresented people in the profession that they are coming into. And we have lots more examples, which I'd be happy to talk about, but I'm fond of these, so we'll stay there. Third question, what resources I would recommend? I could go on forever about this. There's so much great out there, and this is a really important question because this is really hard work. It's emotionally and intellectually challenging, and you need to go get your stuff and your people, right? So anything published by Library Juice Press is amazing. If I could give one example, they have a great book called Information Literacy and Social Justice that I would recommend. There's another book that's called The Feminist Reference Desk, which is fantastic. Writing outside of library land can be really important. Writing scholars in information land like Anna Lauren Hoffman and Sophia Noble. Sophia Noble has a great book coming out next week. I have a pre-publication copy. It's called Algorithms of Oppression. She gave a talk at ACRL in 2015 called Searching for Black Girls on Google about algorithmic bias. That was just amazing. Self-plug, I co-authored a paper with Anna Hoffman about library practices and history and how those can lead us to a more just, complex notion of access than we typically tend to use. I'd be happy to talk about that more. I also really like writing in critical pedagogy, so like Paulo Freire, Bell Hooks, Martin Buber, I think are all really important because I think of libraries as spaces for teaching and learning, and I'm sure many of you do too. Go find your coworkers and colleagues who have enthusiasm and interest for this work. That kind of community can be so important when you're engaging in social justice work. And also, I'm really concerned lately. I feel like I've been seeing a lot of conversations, hearing a lot of conversations, colleagues talking about trying to make library land kind of their be-all, end-all, and really draining themselves and really engaging with a lot of emotional labor past the point that they need to and to the point that they're kind of hurting themselves. So I'm inclined to think of libraries as spaces where we can work toward justice. And given this, I think it's important for people to ground themselves in something other than library practice while also grounding themselves in library practice when they're doing this kind of work. So past experiences, personal philosophy, political beliefs, faith, traditions, skills and lessons you've learned in other contexts can be really important. So I wanna thank you all for hanging in while I sorted out my technical challenges and for your attention, and I look forward to your questions and conversations. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Raina. I really appreciate all your perspective and the things that you're doing to make staff accountable to do this work as well is really interesting and exciting. And I think overall, it's so humbling, as Raina used the word, humbling and inspiring to hear from our community to take on this challenge, right? This is such a large challenge, but to take it on and to be making a difference. And the other piece that I love from a WiLS perspective is be able to bring together all these people from different types of libraries who are able to share information. We can all learn from one another, which is always our goal. And it's super exciting to see that carried out today. So thanks to all of our speakers. So we would encourage you to go ahead and put any questions you have for the speakers into the chat, and hopefully they'll be willing to answer them that way. We didn't really talk about this ahead of time, so I hope our speakers are going to stick around and are able to answer some questions if you put them into chat. One other thing I did want to mention really quickly, Raina mentioned Dr. Noble. She was actually our keynote speaker for WiLS World last year. We're kind of carrying on in her theme a little bit with a new keynote. Our 2018 keynote will be Sarah Roberts, who looks at social media and information workers and how people are who are kind of moderating some of those comments and work within social media. So we're excited to have her speak in July at WiLS World, which will be July 24th. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Andy for our prompt number one roundup.
Thanks, Steph. Hi, everybody. This is Andy Coffin, and I want to thank you all for sharing your thoughts to the question that we answered earlier. So what barriers to your library have prevented users from accessing its resources and services? It's really impressive to see these responses, especially coming just right off the cuff. You're definitely thinking about these questions, so I'm going to kind of give a brief summary of the themes that we saw in those responses. Some common barriers you identified are staff attitudes, so attitudes of distrust, not understanding privilege, language and cultural barriers between staff and patrons, a collection that's not meaningful to users, and lack of adequate staffing or lack of faculty or teacher buy-in getting people in the library. A lack of promotion or patron awareness of services and resources, fines as a barrier to your library, rules that are not obvious to patrons, but that staff think should be obvious to everybody, transportation, lack of access to the internet, budget restrictions, lack of technical information literacy or search skills among patrons. So clearly you guys are thinking about these questions, and I know that list kind of sounds like a bit of a bummer, but we're going to turn it around with our second prompt and ask you what you're doing or what you think you could do to remove those barriers to your library resources and services. We're going to take a quick little break to give you a couple of minutes to respond to this. The link is in the chat. I'm putting it there again. Oh, and Melody also put it there. So you can enter your responses to this question there. Take a couple of minutes, and then we will resume in just a few with some WiLS staff highlights from the last year.
Okay, everybody, welcome back. Hopefully that gave you a couple minutes to think a little bit about the prompt, and also to, if you have any questions for our presenters. I can see that Raina's sharing some things in there and in the chat, so please feel free to go ahead and answer questions and ask questions or share your thoughts in the chat while we continue. So the next part of our presentation today is going to be our WiLS highlights. This is an opportunity for our staff members to share a little bit about what's going on with WiLS. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Sarah Gold.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, everybody.
This is Sarah.
It sounds like I'm getting a big echo.
Yeah, one second. Okay, I just tried muting myself.
Are folks getting an echo?
I am not.
Okay, I'll just go ahead and talk.
I'm causing the echo.
Not valid.
Okay.
Oh, it's gone.
Okay. Sorry about that, guys.
Anyway, I work with primarily
WiLS members on different projects, and I'm so excited to talk about a project that has been 4 years in the making. So this is the WS DLC, and after 4 years of thoughtful planning and development, the Wisconsin School Digital Library Consortium went live in January. The WSDLC, which is how we refer to it, provides access to digital materials at a very low cost to public, private, and soon to be homeschooled students. The WSDLC is overseen by an interim board whose members include Wisconsin media specialists, two of which are on the call today, Jen Peterson and Peg Billing, representatives from DPI, a representative from the Cooperative Educational Services Service Agency, also known as the CESAs, as well as CESA Purchasing and WiLS. The WSDLC launched with 83 districts and schools on board. Overdrive, which was selected through a very extensive RFP process, is the content provider for the initial collection, although other vendors may be added at some time in the future. The WSDLC collections contain nearly 4,000 ebooks at this point, and they are in three collections by grade level, which include K-4, 5-8, and 9-12. Schools and districts are able to join the consortium for $1.50 per student with no additional fees, which is making ebooks accessible for many of the smaller and rural districts in Wisconsin. Those that have existing Overdrive collections can keep that content for their students in addition to adding the consortium content, which is great because we have quite a number of districts that already had Overdrive with their individual district and school collections. We do have an open enrollment period, again, which is now February until April, and detailed information can be found on the WSDLC website, which I put on my site. And with that, I will go ahead and turn it over to Melissa, who is going to talk about digital preservation initiatives.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear me okay.
So in 2017, we began a process to start working towards shared solutions for digital preservation for our members. Specifically, we convened multi-type discussions and surveyed members about digital preservation in order to understand their needs related to digital preservation and to formulate a plan for collaborative digital preservation in the state and to try to understand our role in that initiative. So in the summer of last year, WiLS administered an online survey. That picture isn't online, but it's still a survey, so close enough. Online survey to assess members' digital preservation needs, activities, and challenges. The survey questions were adapted from a similar survey that was administered to UW Libraries by COOL, the Council for UW Libraries Digital Preservation Task Force, in the spring of 2017. Some key findings across both surveys included that few libraries have policies in place related to digital preservation. It is rare to have any staff dedicated to digital preservation, even as part of a position. Most libraries are dealing with storage and access or similar types of content. So many of the members reported that they have digital content such as images, text, audio, and video. Adequate storage space for digital assets is a significant barrier. And though storage itself isn't preservation, it certainly is a prerequisite. And proper storage is crucial to being able to collect and build digital collections in the first place. In fact, there were survey respondents who reported that they are not actively collecting or have, in fact, turned down digital materials due to lack of resources and storage space. The two most significant barriers that our survey takers reported were, one, a lack of funding or staffing, which is hardly surprising, and two, a lack of knowledge or expertise in the area. So the second big activity that we did was we invited stakeholders representing academic, public, and special libraries from around the state to participate in a half-day summit held in August of 2017 at our Friends of Fitchburg Public Library location. Attendees had high interest in digital preservation and varying skills of expertise, and we included administrators as well. So a few of the bigger themes that arose during that summit were that there's a lot of interest in keeping the conversation going. People really appreciated being able to talk to each other about this topic. Attendees also found that digital preservation is an area of high need across member types, and it's ripe for a shared approach. Summit attendees also felt that staffing is key to any approach, but as the survey indicated, funding for staff is lean across the board. They also felt that an umbrella organization may be needed to maintain continuity and to lower the barrier of entry for both small and large institutions. And summit attendees stated that there's a cost to not preserving digital content, just as there's a cost to not heating your building in the winter. So two major outcomes to this initiative at this point. First, we are going to keep the conversation going. Folks really wanted to establish mechanisms for sharing expertise and information among summit participants and the wider Wisconsin library community. In fact, we've been back in contact with our summit participants in order to find out the best way to keep that conversation going. And we'll be setting up a digital preservation email list for members to share ideas and ask questions. If that's something that you're interested in being part of, you can feel free to email me and we'll get you on there, melissa@wils.org. The other outcome of the strategic initiative was a recommendation to consider the Recollection Wisconsin Consortium as the umbrella organization to facilitate statewide collaboration around digital preservation. This recommendation was presented to and approved by the WiLS Board and Recollection Board in the fall of 2017. As Wisconsin's service hub for the Digital Public Library of America, Recollection Wisconsin already works with a strong statewide network of libraries and cultural heritage organizations that are creating and managing digital content. In addition, Recollection Wisconsin's new IMLS grant, Curating Community Digital Collections, is an opportunity to hopefully pilot some initiatives such as shared storage and peer-to-peer learning, particularly for smaller institutions. And this is also a perfect segue to have Emily speak a little bit more about CCDC.
Hi, thanks, Melissa. This is Emily Fotenhauer. I'm the program manager for Recollection Wisconsin and part of the WiLS team. And I'm excited to get to share with you some information about this new grant-funded initiative that Recollection Wisconsin just launched in December. So Curating Community Digital Collections, or CCDC, is a two-year initiative supported by a grant from the IMLS Laura Bush 21st Century Librarian Program. And this initiative will provide library school graduate students from both UW-Madison and UW-Milwaukee with practical experience in digital stewardship through summer fieldwork positions at small and under-resourced libraries and cultural heritage organizations across Wisconsin. So the participating students and the host organizations will both receive training in digital curation and mentoring from digital information professionals, and they'll work together as teams to manage, preserve, and provide access to existing digital content. So that might include cultural heritage materials that have been digitized or born digital resources like web archives or audio or video files. So this initiative has three main goals. The first one is to provide modern and relevant real-world work experiences for aspiring information professionals. And again, this comes, this will bring in students from both the iSchool at UW-Madison and the School of Information Studies, SOAS, at UW-Milwaukee, including both on-campus and distance students. Another goal is to increase the capacity of smaller organizations, libraries, and cultural heritage institutions in Wisconsin to better curate, manage, and preserve their digital content. One way of thinking about that is sort of an archives perspective of getting the boxes off the floor. So not the physical content, getting that off the floor and better managed, but getting the digital content, the virtual stuff, virtually off the floor and in more stable and accessible environments. In a sort of broader long-term sense, our goal is to build local and enduring communities of practice related to digital curation and preservation. So to that end, we'll be sharing the workflows, training materials, and other resources that will be developed over the course of this project with the broader Wisconsin library community. So stay tuned over the next several months and years as we develop these resources. So if this opportunity might sound like a good fit for your library, or maybe for a local historical organization or museum in your community, now is the time to apply for the summer 2018 cohort. So applications for the six host sites that we'll select this summer are due at the end of the month, February 28th. Or if we have any library school students on the line, or you happen to know a library school student who this might be a good fit for, now is the opportunity to apply for those positions as well. These are paid practicum opportunities for this summer. And information about both application processes and the overall project are available at our website. I'll put that link in the chat. And if the timing isn't right for you now to participate, you'll have another opportunity to participate next year. In summer 2019, we'll be working with a larger cohort of 10 local host sites and 10 graduate students. So now I will turn it over to my colleague, Jeff Bruner.
Hello, everyone. I will be talking a little bit about an initiative that's going on right now, one of our 2018 initiatives, and that is our cooperative purchasing redesign process. So a little bit of history. When WiLS reorganized in 2013, most of our services were evaluated and changed to fit the new business model. However, one of our biggest services, cooperative purchasing, was left almost entirely alone and brought over to the new WiLS as it was. I think this was mostly because the service was working well, and because it is so large and complex, it made sense just to keep it going for a while. Now, 4 years on, the time really has come to look critically at cooperative purchasing to ensure that it's still meeting the needs of our members and keeping up with the times. So we, the kind of cooperative purchasing team at WiLS, has developed a redesign process that will happen over the course of 2018, which should help us to identify what our member libraries really want from this service and give us the tools to deliver that. So the first stage, which is happening right now, is a series of discussions with many other consortia and cooperative purchasing groups around the country. You can see some of their logos here on the screen. These are some of the folks we're talking to. And we're getting really great information from them about how they provide these types of services to their members. The goal of that is to develop a list of service offerings that these organizations provide to their members that we can then present to our members for feedback. And so that brings me to the happening in the spring. We'll be gathering feedback from our members on this list of potential services, and we'll do that in a variety of ways with the goal of coming up with a representative list of the things that are most important to our member libraries. We'll have more information about how members can participate in that process soon. So you will be hearing from us both individually, and there will probably be opportunities at kind of the spring library conferences to engage with us as well. Then in the summer, using the information that we gather from members in the spring, we'll research and develop new models or new ways of providing these services based on that information that should allow us to best offer the components that are most important to the members. So then in the fall, we should have a new model ready to propose. We'll take that to our cooperative purchasing committee and to our WiLS board to get their feedback and approval, with the goal of late in the year being able to implement the new processes, and if all goes to plan, we'll begin 2019 with a brand new model in place. So that brings me to, actually, I'm going to go ahead and hand things over to Andy Coffin, who will talk to us a little bit about open access.
Hi, everybody. This is Andy. Thanks, Jeff. So open access and open educational resources have been really important issues, especially to our academic library members, and we want to help support them as they move their own initiatives forward. So one of WiLS' initiatives for the last year was to discover and share information about educational opportunities and other open access initiatives, and to participate in some of those organizations that promote open access to show our support and also facilitate learning among our member community. And to learn more about the field as it develops ourselves. So one of the things we did to help share information about developments in the world of open access and OER was create a web page dedicated to it. We're sharing posts on there, and I just put a link in the chat. And we continue to add posts to it. It's, you know, events and reports and interviews and all sorts of things related to open access and open educational resources. In June of 2017, we presented a WiLS World Shorts on open educational resources with Annie Bauman of Viterbo University, and on her library's journey implementing OER among her community. And then not long after WiLS began exploring OER as our own strategic initiative, WISPALS, which is a technical college library consortium that WiLS acts as project manager for, they identified OER as a shared goal among its member libraries as well. So a few WISPALS members convened a meeting of interested libraries at the 2017 WLA annual conference to discuss the topic. And from that conversation, a special interest group through WLA called the Community for Open Wisconsin, or COW, was developed, and participation has broadened pretty extensively to include many other academic libraries beyond just the WISPALS members. WiLS continues to be involved in that effort and others to help our members move forward their initiatives in open access and open educational resources. And with that, I'm going to turn this over to Bruce Smith to talk about a project we did with Beloit Public Library.
Thanks, Andy. This is Bruce, and I am going to talk a little bit about one of our consulting projects we've recently finished. As we continue with the work of providing consulting services to libraries and for a variety of needs, we always try to find new approaches to our work that best help the library reach the goals it has for the project, and also at the same time address any challenges that exist. With that, the Beloit Public Library approached us as it considered how it might reimagine how its patrons access and receive services through the service points in the library. They had identified an inspiration library that was sparking what they envisioned as possibilities for their library. However, the question came up from staff about how do they really know this Inspirations Library model is best for Beloit? So understanding their needs and understanding their challenges, we developed a staff-inclusive user experience research-based process to come up with recommendations to design the best Beloit model. I'd like to talk about how we start this project. So what we started this project with was first developing project principles used to guide the project. The first principle was that this would be an iterative design process that will use research and the study of other libraries, information from patrons and staff to define, design, and prototype any service model ideas, along with testing any of those ideas out to further develop the models and understand the needs of what it might take to support any changes in the library from the perspectives of staff, patrons, and space. An example of this, as you see on here, is on the left, is we had the staff do a service blueprinting activity where the staff during an in-service day created step-by-step service blueprints of how patrons are currently accessing certain services and resources. This allowed them to really put themselves in the shoes of their patrons. They also developed a survey for patrons to find out what the patrons were using and what their when they were in the library and what issues they had or desires they had for services there. And lastly, they also hopped into the car and visited libraries around the region of those that have already reimagined how they provide their services. The second principle was that this would be a staff-based team approach that includes active staff participation throughout the study and design process and be strength-based staff development support as a key component of any implementation and change management process. During this time, there were multiple points in the process when the staff throughout the library were included from an exercise to identify their sacred cows that create challenges to change, a prioritization survey that the staff filled out of potential changes to identify what were the low-hanging fruit and what they felt would be best for their patrons, and departmental conversations to discuss change ideas and how they would go about implementing them. The third principle was that the lens of this process would be customer focused. And by customer, we refer to two customers. First, it's the patrons who use the services in the library, so the design of access and use of those services. And the second is the staff themselves for any changes and how they would impact the workflows of the staff based on what they would redesign. So from this, we worked with in partnership a 5-member project team. And here in the picture, you can see they're standing around a new entrance desk to the Milwaukee Public Library's East Branch, one of their visits around the region to look at how a new library or a new location looked at designing service points. We worked with them to design and coordinate this project. The staff then took the information gathered and us facilitating them through various processes, drafted a recommendation report of staff-supported service changes that the library could make that the team delivered to the director and board to consider for how the library moves forward to make the best Beloit model. So this is just some of the ways that we try to work with libraries to help them take their ideas to action. And speaking of that, Melody now is going to talk to you about our Ideas to Action Fund.
Bruce, this is Melody. Yes, I'm so excited to be able to share with all of you about our new project. So the WiLS Ideas to Action, to Action Fund is a new program that provides WiLS members with support to undertake a project. So there are some guidelines for these projects. The projects need to include one of the two things, either begin the development of a collaborative project or consortium, or develop an innovative project process or resource that can be used by multiple members of the Wisconsin community. The first year of this program will be a pilot year, so a minimal number of applications will be awarded. The intended goals of this project, as you can see on the screen, are to encourage the development of collaborative projects, and we at WiLS really believe in fostering collaboration and in the benefits of doing so. So that's definitely a number one goal. Another goal is to assist members in reaching their goals, to encourage innovation and the dissemination of results, whether the project is deemed a success or not. That is also really important to us, the process. Of course, we want our members to be successful, but that's not always 100% guaranteed, right? So we really want to encourage the try or the process, because we know there is so much value in the process and we learn so much from that. And then finally, our goal is to provide opportunities for our members to learn about innovations. So how is this going to work? Support for these projects can either be through monetary awards or through WiLS staff time. The annual investment of funds and time will be determined by a review committee, and the whole process and program will be overseen by this committee. The committee consists of a few board members, a few WiLS staff members, and a WiLS finance committee member. The finance committee and board did determine that the amount for the pilot year will not exceed the surplus from the previous fiscal year. So if there's no surplus from the previous fiscal year, there won't be any funds awarded and so forth. In future years, we hope this will be sustainable, but we may have years where no funds will be rewarded. Steph, you can go on to the next slide. So the requirements, there are a number of requirements for applicants, including the organization must be a WiLS member. The outcome and project must be freely available to the community. That sharing component is really important to us. And the organization must agree to complete the project in a timely manner, which would be approved by the committee. And there are a couple of other requirements, as you can see listed on the screen. So this program will begin this year, opening applications hopefully this spring. So stay tuned, and we'll be sending more information out about this. Thanks. And I think I'm going to turn it over now to Jeff.
Hi, everyone. It's me again. I'm here to do a little roundup of our second discussion prompt, which was, what do you think you could do or what have you done to remove barriers to your library resources and services? We got a lot of responses, and a couple of themes came up multiple times. One of those was reducing or eliminating fees and fines of various types in a variety of ways. And also one thing that was in the an alternative way to satisfy fines, which was food bank donations. So I think that's a really cool way of doing something like that too. Another of the bigger themes that came through was additional instruction opportunities and more collaborative approaches to instructional opportunities, both just general kind of library instruction and outreach in terms of awareness about what the library has to offer to increase kind of accessibility of the resources through awareness. A few other things that came up that I thought were cool were home delivery of library resources for folks that might not be able to actually make it into the library building. So that would be kind of cool. And alternatives to traditional library cards, possibly using like a school student ID. And some in-building changes to the layout or to signage around the building. So thanks, everybody, for those great ideas. And I think at this point, I'm handing the ball back to Steph.
Unmuted.
Thank you so much, Jeff. So that was the roundup of projects we wanted to share with you today. We are going to have our annual report available very soon, probably within the next day or so. And so that will be posted to our website, and we'll send that out through all of our communication channels, but it'll include more information about projects that we worked on in 2017, along with our full financial report for 16-17. So with that, I just wanted to thank all of our speakers so much for presenting, and including the WiLS staff as well as our community speakers, and to thank all of you for being here, and more importantly, for being part of the WiLS community. We really value all of our members, and we're so happy that you're willing to be here today and to learn from one another. So as I said, we'll be posting the recording of this meeting along with the slides. We'll post the links to the poll results. So all of that will be available for your perusal after the meeting. And before we let you go though, we just wanted to put in a last pitch for some upcoming events. So we have a WiLS World Short coming up on March 9th at 1 o'clock. on building curiosity, confidence, and community through making. That's going to be presented by some folks from DEMCO who've been doing a lot of research and will have a lot of experience in this area. Our peer council will be June 4th at the Madison Public Library. That is our event for technical services librarians from all types of libraries. And last but not least, our WiLS World 2018 conference will be July 24th and 25th at the Pyle Center in Madison. July 24th will be the conference day, and July 25th will be a series of workshops. So we hope to see all of you soon at some of our upcoming events. And thank you again for being with us today.